One of the constant questions of games discourse, thankfully lessened now, is asking when games will have their Citizen Kane, when the work will appear that legitimizes the medium and shows what it's truly capable of. Now, there's some serious gaps in theory here, a misunderstanding of what makes Citizen Kane actually important, an insistence on judging one medium by the achievements of the other, and a misplaced sense of what games should be aiming for. But there's one which has always needled me, and which led to the creation of this project. By the time Citizen Kane was released, films had been mass media entertainment for nearly 50 years. Its low angles and realistic sets were made possible by having smaller and more portable cameras and microphones. Its use of deep focus and ability to show multiple layers of action between foreground and background could only be done with cutting-edge advances in film and camera technology. The makeup effects, which allowed Wells to tell a story spanning decades, would have been impossible without panchromatic film, which had been in wide use for just 19 years. Even the dialogue of the movie, naturalistic, overlapping, and a break from the stage-like work preceding it, required heavy use of the day's best radio and editing equipment. Citizen Kane is the result of 5 decades of technological and stylistic innovation, made almost entirely by artists and technicians who had never known a world without film. Pong entered wide release in 1972, with arcade games finally breaking into mass consciousness by the late 70s, and with story-driven games like Zork reaching home computers around the same time. For a comparison to film, the first wide-release sound picture didn't come out until 30 years after movies had become popular entertainment.
It is a picture of me, and I am talking.
Video games are such a young medium that everything from the Atari's Adventure to Red Dead Redemption could fit within the time span covered by the silent film era. And it was in this spirit that indie game developer Joe Blair and I set out to make an argument via remix. Rather than waiting for the medium Citizen Kane, we should instead be rejoicing that we already have its Joan of Arc, its battleship Potemkin, its man with a movie camera. Like the film lovers of the 20s and 30s, we have decades of art to draw from that was not realistic, that was severely limited by its technology, and yet excelled within those limits. Just as silent movies had to tell a story with minimal dialogue and build beautiful worlds in monochrome, and actors had to express themselves on a medium that couldn't capture their voices or small movements, games had to tell sweeping epics and grand adventures with 3-color sprites and 4-track music. Were they unrealistic? Were they simplistic? Did the seams show? None of this makes them any less important. None of it diminishes the power of what they did right. And there's another, sadder point of comparison. How fragile this art is. There's been a lot written on how much older games are reliant on emulation and piracy to make them playable to new audiences, and how many games are lost forever. But this is something which characterized the early days of film as well. We spent decades thinking that the complete version of Carl Dreyer's The Passion of Joan of Arc had been lost forever, until someone found the film canisters in a janitor's closet in a mental institution. Hitchcock's second movie will never be seen. And famously, Fritz Lang's Metropolis has been lost or damaged for almost its entire life. For 83 years, the only versions available were still missing 25 minutes of footage or more. And even the best restored version still had 2 scenes too damaged to save. Joe and I were inspired by this shared history of fragility and limitation to make, essentially, a roundabout argument for the value of the past. Metropoloid. For 60 years, it was impossible to see Metropolis with its original score, leaving it wildly open to interpretation. Famously, electronic musician Giorgio Moroder released a version which added new effects shots and a new wave soundtrack. And while I don't much like his cut,
the dance tells a lie.
I'll absolutely agree with his claim that it was wrong to criticize him for altering a film for which there exists no unaltered version. Nearly every cut of Metropolis has had to re-score the film, At every score and every edit are arguments about what Lang's original intent should be, or what best serves the movie. With no original Metropolis left, every version becomes an interpretation. We decided to make our version a celebration of the primitive, the ephemeral, and the limited in both mediums of art. Drawing from the 2001 restoration, which features most of the best-known cuts, and, more importantly for our purposes, is generally considered to be in the public domain, we assembled a score drawn from Metropolis's peers in video games, works that use their music to do emotional heavy lifting in the absence of realistic graphics or voice acting. Just as Metropolis built an enormous spectacle using in-camera effects on black-and-white film, the games quoted here were all exciting, or tragic, or grandiose, despite having no voices, or 2D graphics, or mute protagonists, or any other number of a host of unreal and artificial elements. This is music designed to fill in the gaps, to carry the story where words can't, to build a grandiose world out of tiny pieces, and in doing so, it has to do much the same work that the artists making silent films did. We found it a natural pairing, a project that started as a fun diversion but ended up deepening our love of both the movie and the games we drew from. We hope it does the same for you.
We'll be right back. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.